Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Rutherford Congregational Church. May the fire and light of the Lord fill this place and every soul in it today.
Amen.
Amen.
Today is Mental Health Sunday. We will hear about how Jesus healed those with mental illness. And together we will reflect on how we can show compassion and possibly advocate for those with mental illness. And also, it is our pleasure to welcome our guest speaker today, Pilar Arsenek, who will share a personal story of struggle and victory over mental health.
Amen.
A word about our worship experience this morning. Our worship team hopes to provide you with a worship experience that is epic. Epic stands for experiential, participatory, image-rich, and connected. A note about our worship music. Our worship team attempts to provide a wide variety of music, everything from traditional to contemporary and everything in between. Everyone is welcome to participate in worship at whatever level is comfortable for you. Whether you read a scripture, clap your hands, sing out loud, or sit quietly in your seats or at home on Zoom, may you feel God's presence today as we join together in worship. And a note for our Zoom members. Yes, you're here. Good morning, Jackie. Good morning, Jean-Paul, Manuel, Doug from California. We have Florida, California, Passaic. And Manuel, God bless you and welcome. I got a wave from Manuel. See, he's using his, Manuel is using his reaction buttons, which you can use to throw a wave or a heart or a thumbs up. You can also unmute yourself for joys and concerns to share with the congregation. And for a copy of today's order of worship or to view a YouTube recording of today's worship service, you can go to our home webpage, www.rccucc.com. And a reminder to you that here in this local congregation of the United Church of Christ, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcomed here.
Amen.
Now let us begin our service with our musical prelude, My Faith, It Is an Oaken Staff, performed by Phil and Suzanne Reynolds.
My faith.
you'll join me in the call to worship on page 3 of your bulletin. Grace and peace to you in Jesus, our liberating light of the world.
And also with you.
Jesus, in the Gospels, we read that you went from town to village teaching.
Come, Lord, and teach us today.
Jesus, in the Gospels, we also read that you heal the sick of all their afflictions.
Come, Lord, heal us today.
Jesus, in you we learn God's heart.
Lord, teach us God's will.
Jesus, in you we learn what makes for peace.
Lord, teach us to do justice, love mercifully, and walk humbly. Amen.
Let us pray. God of all creation, we come today to give honor and praise for your steadfast love and care. We raise Lord Jesus, who healed the sick and showed us what compassion looks like. We come to comfort in those turbulent times. We come to give thanks for our many blessings. Be with us in this gathering today. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Our opening hymn is One in Christ, which is lots of fun. We found out this morning, so join me. It is our tradition at the Rutherford Congregational Church to hold our prayer time as close to the beginning of worship as we can, as Jesus started his day, every day, in prayer. At this time, we will share our joys and concerns with one another, our prayer requests. We also share our celebrations. Then we will take some time for some silent meditation, and we will conclude with the Lord's Prayer. And if we can pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
And now let us greet each other with words of peace, love, and blessings as we encounter the living Christ in one another.
Peace to you. God bless you.
Peace, Brenda.
Thanks to Fred and Alicia. If you'd like to follow along in your bulletin, the contemporary reading and the gospel lesson is found on page 4. You are the one thing in this world above all other things that you must never give up on. When I was in middle school, I was struggling with severe anxiety and depression, and the help and support I received from my family and a therapist saved my life. Asking for help is the first step. You are more precious to this world than you'll ever know.
Amen.
That was written by Lily Reinhardt.
Yes.
There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in.
Amen.
Written by Leonard Cohen.
Amen.
Listen for what the Spirit is saying to you. Amen. Our gospel lesson is Mark 1, verses 21 through 28. A man with an evil spirit. Jesus and his disciples came to the town of Capernaum, and on the next Sabbath, Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. The people who heard him were amazed at the way he taught, for he wasn't like the teachers of the law. Instead, he taught with authority. Just then, a man with an evil spirit came into the synagogue and screamed, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you here to destroy us? I know who you are. You are God's holy messenger." Jesus ordered the spirit, "Be quiet and come out of the man." The evil spirit shook the man hard, gave a loud scream, and came out of him. The people were all so amazed that they started saying to one another, "What is this? Is this some kind of new teaching? This man has authority to give orders to evil spirits, and they obey him." And so the news about Jesus spread quickly everywhere in the province of Galilee. Listen for what the Spirit is saying to you.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Ellen,
for those readings.
Yeah,
first, I want to thank Suzanne Reynolds for consistently reminding us to pray for those with mental illness.
Amen.
Even today, with all our sophistication in modern medicine, mental illness remains one of the most misunderstood and stigmatized of all medical conditions.
Yes.
If someone has a broken elbow, our congregation, we've had three, they receive a lot of care and compassion.
Absolutely.
We sign their casts, we carry their items, and help them to get along until their elbows heal. If someone has cancer, we pray fervently. We send cards and we visit them. We join organizations. We raise money. We go on walks for cures. Yet, most people with mental illness, whether it be anxiety, depression, behavioral, emotional, eating disorders like bulimia or anorexia, obsessive compulsive disorder, paranoia, PTSD, schizophrenia, borderline personalities, addictions, or any number of illnesses that limit, impair, or disable any of us are largely stigmatized and ignored. But as Christians, we are called to live like Jesus lived, providing health and healing, and most of all, compassion. Our gospel lesson today tells of the first account of Jesus healing someone that had a demon or evil spirit controlling them. This account was recorded in the very first gospel, in the very first chapter. I'll reread just a little bit of it as Ellen read Mark 1, a man with an evil spirit. Jesus and his disciples had come to the town of Capernaum in Galilee, and on the Sabbath day, Jesus went to preach in the synagogue. Just then, a man with an evil spirit came into the synagogue and screamed, "Are you trying to destroy us? You are God's holy messenger?" And Jesus ordered the spirit to be quiet and to come out of the man. The evil spirit shook the man hard, gave a loud scream, and departed. There are many, many more accounts recorded of Jesus healing those with what at the time were considered evil spirits or some sorts of demons. In Mark 5, in Gerasa, which is across the lake from Galilee, there was a man living in a graveyard, howling and bruising himself with rocks. In Mark 7:26, Jesus healed the daughter of a Galatian woman in Phoenicia of Syria. In Mark 9:38, we see others driving out demons in Jesus' name. In Mark 16:9, Jesus was known to drive out 7 demons from Mary Magdalene. In the 21st century, what was once thought to be this demonic possession, we now understand as mental illness. The National Alliance on Mental Illness, the National Institute for Mental Illness, the Center for Disease Control, and the American Medical Association all cite similar statistics, that there are 58 million Americans living, that represents 1 in 5 adults. So if there are 20 of us here, including myself, there would be 4 others that have some sort of mental disorders of one side or the other. That's 1 in 4. There are 14 million Americans that suffer from serious, debilitating, serious illnesses, and nearly 8 million youth and 20 million have some substance abuse disorder that may or may not accompany a underlying mental condition. The World Health Organization estimates that close to 2/3, that 66% of mental illnesses go undiagnosed and untreated. Over half of the people with any sorts of mental distress suffer in silence, in isolation, and invisibility. Today, I would like to shed a glimmer of light into the darkness of the invisibility of mental illness. I have invited my friend, my sister, Pilar Arsnek, to share her personal story in hopes that we will develop more compassion and possibly act to help those who suffer. And you welcome Pilar.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Annie, and I want to thank everyone for their service to make this possible. I'm really thankful for people in the Zoom room. Hello, everyone. My name is Pilar, and this is my story. I grew up in a domestic violence situation since I was a kid. My dad was a hard worker, but he and my mom had horrible fights and physical fights. And this is how I grew up. So they were so immersed in that, they weren't able to really notice me and what was happening with me. And so as I was growing, you know, like 6, 7 years old, I had situations happen to me, and they didn't know about it. And once I just started to drink, basically. I didn't really know what was happening. Like, I'm just kind of giving you the fundamental, you know, foundation, and then I'm going to jump into what I'm going to say. I started to drink very early, and I didn't know why I was doing it. All I know is that it made me feel better. I started going to school. I started dealing, I would call it nervousness. I didn't know the word anxiety. I didn't know the word depression. I didn't know the word addictions. I didn't know any of that. All I know was that I was just trying to survive, and I had no one. My parents were not there for me, and neither were my peers. So I had to figure everything out for myself. By the time I was 13, I was literally drinking and getting drunk. And I had other things happen to me at that time, you know, that I don't really want to get into specifics because I want to just gauge into the mental illness part. But it set off other things. And I didn't know what was wrong with me, but I knew that there was something different about me. And I just didn't know what to do. I actually started going to seeing a therapist at the age of 15 by myself. I just would take up, I went and found a therapist and started talking to a therapist because I had no one to talk to and I didn't know what was wrong with me. So I started doing that, but she really couldn't help me because she kept falling asleep every time I talked in sessions. So that wasn't working out very well. So by the time I was, you know, in my teens, late teens, I was drinking fully, and I didn't know what was going on with me. And then I eloped with an alcoholic, and then I was in a domestic violent marriage for 13 years. I'm going fast forward. And then I started going to therapy again. I spoke to a psychiatrist, and they basically said that I had post-traumatic stress disorder for all the abuse that I had gone through as a child, from various people and from my family. And I didn't know what that meant, and I didn't care. And nobody suggested any medication to me at that point. But I started to get also involved in the church. I started going to Times Square Church, all these famous kind of churches, and I would try to talk to pastors to tell them, you know, there's something wrong with me. I'm like, I feel down all the time. I feel really like my heart's racing, and you know, I had my first major panic attack on 42nd Street and 6th Avenue. I'll never forget it. And I was rushed to Mount Sinai, and then they said, "Oh, dear, you didn't have a heart attack. You had a panic attack." I didn't know what that was. I didn't know why I had it. But I just I started wanting to speak to pastors because, okay, if therapists fall asleep, this one is just telling me I have that. I said, well, maybe I'll go this route. And so that spiraled into having people tell me I had demon possession. So why I'm saying this right now like this is that God doesn't make any mistakes.
Amen.
And there was a reason why Pastor Annie told me to come speak. And there was a reason why that particular scripture and how she expounded on it was that there was a reason God wanted her to. Because that was me. I literally was dealing with pastors and clergy that every time I would go to them, they told me I wasn't doing something right, and that I didn't repent of my sins, and that I needed to, there was something wrong that I did, that I must have sinned somehow, that's why God wasn't delivering me from demons. And that completely turned me off from the church. I literally stopped going because I was getting sicker and sicker. It took for COVID to happen, for me to go into an IOP because I was going to have nervous breakdown from COVID and everything else that was happening in my life at that time. And it was in that setup that I started to face the reality that I'm mentally ill and an alcoholic. And for years, I didn't really want to believe it. You know, every once in a blue, a psychiatrist would say, oh, you have, you know, this, you have that, you have the other. And I didn't want to believe it. I didn't want to take medication. And I forget it. If they tried to prescribe medication to me, I would be like, oh, no, God's not going to want me to take medication. I'd be sinning. I'll sin if I take medication. I cannot do that. So for years, because of all of the different voices and all of the different stigma and all of the different judgments and all of the different things, I wasn't doing what was prescribed to me that would help me until COVID happened and I went into an IOP and I finally broke down. That was like my bottom because I couldn't function. I couldn't live. I couldn't be a mother. I couldn't be a wife. I couldn't be a friend. I couldn't be anything. And I also wanted to drink again. I had stopped drinking just because it's sinful, but I was white knuckling. I don't know if you know that term, but I was just like doing it with force of will. I didn't have any program. So anyway, I started taking medication. It wasn't smooth. It took about 3 years of different types of medications, and because it's not a perfect science, but I can tell you the victory for me is that I can tell you that at the end is that I finally was prescribed the right medications once I wound up in Hackensack Psych Ward back in 2022, And they put me on to my psychiatrist and them and partial hospitalization program. They put me on a right combination of medications. Mm-hmm. And now I can say I'm stable.
Amen.
And I'm living a normal life.
Amen.
You know? So that's my story. It's a very short one. I have a big, big story. But I wanted to, we're centering on mental illness, and I just wanted to give you a positive ending to my story. Please take medication if they prescribe you medication, and that's all I can say.
Thank you, Pilar. Yeah, we have to be personal. It's not about proclamations. It's not about statistics. It's about people and real lives.
Yes.
And as a community of faith, we can make a difference and touch real lives.
Amen.
Real people.
Yes, yes.
And I'm grateful to all of you. Pilar, thank you for sharing your story with us. I am going to invite Bernard. Oh, we have a trio today. Yes. To sing a special song.
What happens when you get old?
Oh. I was going to say older, and might be one of the young ones.
Yeah, I'm coming right over close. And you come close too, dear heart, because we want you in the picture.
Great is your faithfulness, O God.
It's now time for offering. an announcement first is now that we're into the new year, starting in next month, I'll be printing out your statements from last year. What I'll do is I will bring them here, and if you're not here or whatever, I will mail them to you. I am reducing the size. It used to be a lot of formatted stuff. You sat there with a fancy letter and all this. You're going to get the basic one, my thanks, and you can use that for your tax purposes. So we'll make it a lot easier, takes less paper and stuff. And basically, that's what you really want is that statement, not a lot of stuff on top of it. Okay, please take time now to log onto our website, www.rccucc.com, and click on the donate link to make your offering. Or mail your check to RCC P.O. Box 1723, Rutherford, New Jersey, 07070, attention financial secretary. Or you can place it in the offering plate that Tammy has. Please join me in the prayer of dedication, which is printed in bold. We dedicate these gifts for the wondrous ways this offering breeds hope into the community and for the ways it will help us live out God's mission. Let these gifts strengthen our call to carry out God's justice and mercy. Amen.
And our choir will assemble for our closing hymn, Be Not Dismayed.
Amen.
All you may need, God will provide.
care of you.
Yes, you will.
Okay.
You will.
I was fine.
I'll be your king.
And please receive this closing blessing. Beloved, as we leave this place, may we go out with eyes to see the suffering of others. May we feel the pain of others, even when it's not visible.
Yes.
And may we carry the compassion of Jesus to heal, to help the sick and suffering. Amen.
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 And our postlude, never gonna let you down.
Amen.
Lord, when you're feeling low, you just don't know where to run to. Bro, if your heart's been broken, you feel like you're all alone. If you need something to believe in, if you're looking for a light to guide you home, just look inside, your light's shining brighter than should know. I'm never gonna let you down. I'm always gonna build you up. When you're feeling lost, I will always find your love. I'm never gonna walk away. I'm always gonna have your back. And if nothing else, you can always come on back. When you need me, I promise I will never let you down.
This week. As always, Pastor Spiritual Growth Group is Tuesday at 7 on Zoom. I have several announcements, reminders I should say. Don't forget, this coming Saturday on February 3rd, we're having our annual meeting, our congregational meeting at 1 p.m. in person or on Zoom, please try to attend. Or just attend.
Just attend.
And the following day is our Communion Sunday and also our community lunch. So don't forget to bring a dish to share. And Pastor Annie gave me this to announce. On March 6th, we are hosting a nonprofit Small Business Connection Expo. It's open to all members, businesses, and nonprofits. It'll be held here from 6:30 to 9:30 p.m. It's a Wednesday. Showcase your business or nonprofit free of charge. Tables will be provided to all participating members. Expo will be open to the public. Food, refreshments, prizes, community engagement. Limited space is available. Connect with public, nonprofits, and local businesses. Registration is coming soon, so save the date. That's March 6th, and it's hosted by us, and it will be here. So any other questions? See Pastor Annie. Anything else?
That's it, coffee hour.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, have a blessed week.
Recording stopped.
Bye, Jackie. Bye, Manuel. Bye, John. Thank you.
Bye, everybody. Okay, so what did you get? Bye, John Paul, Nanny.